I now call upon Ramya to speak on facilitating ties and enhancing cooperation, the Yunnan factor in China-Myanmar relations.
Very good afternoon to everybody. My topic today is facilitating ties and enhancing cooperation, Yunnan factor in China-Myanmar relations. What I've tried to do is, unlike the previous speakers, I hope I won't repeat too much, but I'm going to stick to specifically China's relations with Myanmar over the years and looking at Yunnan as a specific case study. The format of the presentation is as follows. Taking a look at how external factors are impacting the center-periphery dynamics within Myanmar and situating China as such. Looking at a timeline of China-Myanmar relations, I won't dwell into this too much since it's still historic, quite a bit of history, but I will look at the historical ties between Yunnan and Myanmar as it is my case study. Look at the geography of the entire region. I keep coming back to geography because I think it's absolutely essential for my discussions that we've had over the 2 days on how policy is influenced by your geographic space. Then look at Yunnan's development and Myanmar, how the two feature. Look at the ethnic armed groups and the challenges that China is facing in general in its relations with Myanmar. How is China dealing with the center-periphery conflict in Myanmar? And a couple of observations. So external factors impacting the center-periphery dynamics. Till now, the conference has been focusing on the Burmese identity, the mainland, the Tatmadaw, the ruling elite. On top of this, we've superimposed ethnic groups where the center-periphery dynamic continues. You have Wa, Kachin, I've just listed out a few. And then now we're talking about external factors, such as China. You have the Chinese diaspora that has been in Myanmar over centuries. New age Chinese entrepreneurs who are making their way into Myanmar. And then you have the Chinese government that's formulating its policy. All of these are dictated by three specific indicators: geography, history, and politics. I'll try and deal with each of these in specific. I hope that this model runs throughout the entire presentation and it's clear. So looking at the timeline of China-Myanmar relations, I won't dwell too much into the 17th century to 1947, 1948 to 1962. I've only taken up specific important landmarks. For instance, in 17th century, there was partial suzerainty over Upper Burma by China. Border agreement, it was called a vassal state. Myanmar was called a vassal state. China claimed the town of Bhamo, a Kachin-dominated area, which gave access to ports along the Ayarwadi, while the British sought to make Bhamo a free port area. The setting of a delineation committee was done in 1886, and in 1894, a treaty was signed to give effect to the previous convention. It is significant to note that as part of the border agreement, the British agreed to send delineal commissions to China, which has been cited by China as a claim that Myanmar was historically a part of its own territory. I think this is very significant to note because it shows you how geography and history come together in one country claiming land over the other. Although the border dispute is now resolved, there were certain claims that were made, and this is how the entire narrative was built. Between 48 to 62, broadly the relations between China and Myanmar were categorized as cautious but friendly. In 1952, the PLA attack happened because of the Kuomintang forces, which left a mark on the Tatmadaw as well. And then came the Pokpa phase, that is the cousins phase. From 62 to 88, the relationship was described because of Myanmar's own isolationism policy. There were anti-China protests, as everybody knows. And there was this report by a Chinese daily newspaper, Renmin Ribao, in 1980. And the article stated that this was the beginning of a golden bond of friendship between China and Myanmar. And this is when you actually started seeing changes in the relationship, given the Western sanctions and a lot of other factors that played into it. But the friendship was obviously not of equals. Between 88 to 2002, closer ties, increase in Chinese influence, counter-hedging strategy by China, which possibly led to the transformation that we're looking at right now. 2002 to present, there's been a perception of Myanmar being seen as a land bridge to the Indian Ocean for China. Looking at Yunnan, that's where Yunnan comes into the picture. Spillover of strategic interests, like the previous presenter very eloquently put it, of how all these factors come into play. And friendly relations have continued. Gray areas remain. history as a factor to the relations. There's been a lot of research done on the Sinization of Upper Burma, and this is where you see how Yunnan has kind of made an impact on the northern part of Myanmar. So historical ties between Yunnan and Myanmar, Shans, Kachins, and Chins of northern Burma are said to be from southwestern China, from Yunnan province. Despite cultural, racial, and even linguistic affinities between China and Myanmar, historically Myanmar remained exclusive to Manchu and Ming rule. This is going back to the partial suzerainty that I spoke about, looking at geography as an element. During the rule of Shan King Tarok Man Mingyi, the Chinese attempt to invade Myanmar was thwarted. There are several other occasions when small little kingdoms took control of either the Yunnan side or the Shan side. So there was a partial suzerainty there. Mongols and Ming dynasty established only partial suzerainty over Upper Burma. Historically, the Chinese kings controlled parts of the forests inhabited by the Shans, Kachins, and on other occasions, the Burmese Pa controlled Yunnan province, now which is part of China. This is a really old map that I found that talks about these pull cart regions from Yunnan. I thought it was interesting because you see that these relations didn't develop in a day or Western sanctions, which is why China closed. And I think this gives a lot of perspective to see that these are historical ties and they will remain so. You have Yunnan there, Kunming right at the end, and these are all Mike, Kenya, all of these, which we even today talk about pipelines going through and new projects. It's been historical, it's been there. So we look at geography now. Chinese diaspora and Sinization of Upper Burma. Like I said, it's not new. The Chinese presence in northern towns, however, is growing. Ethnic Chinese, about 3% of the total population. This is how they've been coming over the years and over the centuries. Legal Chinese immigrants, 300,000. Statistics vary. Illegal, as many as 2 million. Mandalay, nearly 30% of the population is Chinese. Lhasa, 50%. Again, the statistics could be grossly exaggerated in some cases and the others not. But this is the rough figure that I got. Most of the major rebel insurgent groups along the Myanmar-China border are the ethnic Shan and Wa. And a lot has been discussed about these. So this is just a perspective of where these regions are and how close they are to the Yunnan province, where you have a lot of Chinese presence, and that's the Wa state. I just put that out to see the new growing relations and the pipeline that's coming through. So Yunnan's development in Myanmar. The relation between the two nations through history has been built around trade, as neither side was decisively victorious over the other. This is looking at the historical precedents that I've given previously. The geoeconomic dimension of promoting China's development policy, especially of the landlocked Yunnan province, strengthened China's need to improve relations with Myanmar. Myanmar was seen as a land bridge for China to revive its southwest Silk Route by providing the southwestern provinces an outlet to the coast through Myanmar. Yunnan was designated a bridgehead for the country's integration with the Association of Southeast Asian Nations and South Asia. There's been heavy investment in road, rail, energy infrastructure, and a lot has been spoken about this in the past 2 days of the conference. And most of these reforms took place between 2000-2009. That's when the heightened approach occurred. And a lot of the ideas that we talk about in terms of the oil and gas pipelines all initiated from the Yunnan province. There was a provincial government that came into place where the central government allowed these periphery hinterlands to compete against each other and bridge their gaps with ASEAN. So if Yunnan had to develop, it did that on its own accord. It pushed its way through, made sure that the central government at Beijing heard them out, and that's how they pushed their entire policy upwards. Some quick facts. The ASEAN-China free trade area, which came into force in January 2010, is a key element of the strategy that I'm going to talk about. There are 5 trade posts on the Myanmar side of the border with the Yunnan province, as listed. I will not try and pronounce them. And then you have infrastructure development, highway links, Mandalay, Lhasa, Meuse Road. All these are very important because from historical times, yes, they've been there, but now you have tangible, easier access. Hydropower projects, again, oil and gas pipelines. What I'd like to point out with all of this is the idea of building the pipeline initially came from Yunnan local province as Yunnan clearly realized that there were enormous economic benefits to be gained if such a plan materialized. Yunnan adopted a variety of strategies to push for this initiative. Firstly, it effectively took advantage of the Malacca Strait dilemma. Some of the most influential media outlets and prominent scholars in China were mobilized to support Yunnan's plan. It also strongly lobbied various ministries in Beijing to gain their support. The Yunnan government's initiative coincided with the Chinese National Petroleum Corporation's plan to expand business in China, China's vast southwestern market, which has been seriously contended among oil giants within China. So this is how you see how Yunnan, in its sense, was essentially propagating its own policy, given the links. Also, you have Yunnan's role in ASEAN sub-regional cooperation, Yunnan-Myanmar Economic and Trade Cooperation Forum. This was provincially done, although it is part of the Chinese major... although China as a whole is seen to be part of the ASEAN network in trying to build ties, I would like to delineate the fact that Yunnan as a province pushed specifically for this policy. Cross-border trade between Yunnan and Myanmar, the first border trade agreement was signed in 1988. By Myanmar Export and Import Services and Yunnan Machine Import Export Corporation to use bank transactions between Myanmar Foreign Trade Bank and Kunming Bank of China. MIAS established the border trade offices in Lasho Mews. Now you see that there's road development in these specific areas as well. Formal border trade agreement was signed in 1994. You also have a border control force that was put in place and use of local currency. However, problems still persist. And that being the ethnic armed groups along the China-Myanmar border. How is China dealing with the center-periphery conflict in Myanmar that we began with? We saw how a provincial government within China interacted with its close neighbors, pushed for a policy. Development seems to be in place. You have these historical ties and baggage that comes with it and a geography that supports it. Beijing policy of non-interference in internal affairs was broken. This is what a large part of scholarly work has indicated, because Beijing tries to stay away from internal politics, quote unquote. But Beijing has been trying to deal with these armed rebel groups independently. The role of the interlocutor, I think this comes through specifically in the Kachin case. 2013, China brokered deals with Kachin rebels. And there's an ethnic semblance with Kachin with the Kachin of Yunnan. What one needs to keep in mind at this stage is that Yunnan itself is a microcosm of a lot of ethnicities. So you have China that has to treat on a really narrow path in how it deals with these two factors. China gave airspace to Myanmar's air force to fight Kachin independent army. Informal arrangement, Kachin state depend on Yunnan province for subsistence. So you have these two approaches that are coming through. You have a Yunnan province that's pushing for its own development, and you have a central government that comes with its baggage of strategic interests. Where do you place these historical ties of Han Chinese, Kokang are Han Chinese, and the Wa army, again, is another story by itself. I think this map was already shown before. These are all the oil and gas projects in Myanmar. If you see the ethnic composition that I showed in the previous slides, are all again in the same region. You have Mandalay, Lasho. The development projects again in the same place is reinforced. And now you have again these new projects historically that have been there. So it's not that it's been a sudden upsurge from the 80s to now. What I'm trying to say is this narrative has continued for a long time. Development of Yunnan and hinterland, strengthening ties with the center. I think all these points have been covered. Other essential factors between China-Myanmar relations is the use of veto at the UNSC and easy loans that were given. So some observations. From whatever little I could understand, feel free to comment later. I think China has a dual approach in how it's dealing with Myanmar. You have a profit-driven provincial government, Yunnan. Pit that against the strategic planning of the central Chinese government. If it is faced with a problem like the Kachin rebel group, you have the central government that's pushing for one policy and the problems persist because you have Yunnan, a provincial government that's carrying out its own set of policies, because of which you have these illegal migration. I'm not saying this is the only reason, but it seems to be like a major driving force. China's facing problems of its own with the transition problems in place. The Mysore Dam, etc., all of these have been spurts of that. But I think these are other larger problems that need to be addressed as well. Strengthened relations with center coupled with tacit support for ethnic armed groups. This is where the two divergent approaches come into play. So China's view, do you support a stronger periphery? If you do, would you place your eggs around that basket? Concerns, refugee issues, of course, anti-China resentment. Has that actually begun? You have narcotic smuggling, all of these other facets to deal with. And Myanmar government on its own, from its behalf, would probably go for a hedging strategy, which is what it is adopting as of now. These are just some references. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, for Ramya, for a very interesting and very different presentation. I must confess that I must compliment all the speakers. They stuck very strictly to the time.